Grace and peace to you and welcome on this 12th Sunday after the Pentecost. We continue our reading from the Gospel of Luke, skipping just a little bit, but staying in the 13th chapter. We hear Jesus having a little tete-a-tete with his arch enemies, the Pharisees. This one's a little more pleasant than others in the past. Jesus talks about the consequences of the choices that we make.
Today we'll be hearing a piece by Edvard Grieg, who is was a composer from Norway. He notated a lot of Norwegian folk songs in his own season, and it's called the Cowkeeper's Tune. It's supposed to be cowkeeper singing to the herds that come back.
You may remain seated for the confession of forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, let us gather with true hearts that confess our sins to God, that earnestly ask for forgiveness, and that trust in our renewal through the work of our Savior, Jesus the Christ.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said I will confess my transgressions to the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
Almighty God, merciful Father,
I confess to you all my sins with which I have offended you and my neighbors. I am sorry for them. I devote myself to repentance and pray for your mercy. In your boundless grace and compassion, send me your Holy Spirit, that I may be strengthened in my faith and made ready for a life obedient to your will and your way. God is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Therefore, in obedience to the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sin in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High Jesus Christ. With the Holy Spirit in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Father of wisdom and understanding, you lay out for us a path for life that leads us away from despair, anxiety, fear, want, and emptiness. Fill us with the Holy Spirit so that we will have the faith necessary to trust and embrace your plans rather than finding confidence in relying on our own. By the grace of Jesus, Do not leave us to suffer too long or too deeply from the logical consequences of the choices we make, but always open to us the way to return to you and ultimately experience the consequence of following faithfully. We ask this in the name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
The first lesson is from 1 Samuel. When the great prophet Samuel became old, he made his sons judges over God's people Israel. Yet his sons did not follow in their father's faithful ways, but turned aside after unjust gain. They took bribes and corrupted justice. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to the prophet Samuel and said to him, "You are old, and your sons do not follow in your ways. So appoint a king for us who will govern us just like in other nations." But Samuel did not think appointing a king over Israel was a good idea. He prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said to Samuel, "Listen to what the people ask of you, for it is not you who they reject in their request, but they are rejecting me as the one who is king over them, as they have always done since the day I brought them up out of Egypt to this day, forsaking me and serving other gods. So go ahead and listen to their voices. Only you will also solemnly warn them and make clear to them the consequences of having a king reign over them." So Samuel spoke the words of the Lord to those who had come asking him to appoint a king over Israel. Samuel said, "This is what your king will do to you. He will draft your sons as his chariot drivers and his horsemen and his infantry who will run before his chariots. And he will appoint for himself commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties. And he will require some of you to plow his ground and to reap his harvest. And he will force you into making his implements of war and the equipment of his chariots. He will take your daughters to his palace to be his perfumers and his cooks and his bakers. He will come and demand the best of your fields and vineyards and olive orchards to serve them in his palace. He will tax you 1/10 of your grain and of your vineyards and give it to his officers and his courtiers. He will take your male and female slaves and the best of your cattle and donkeys and put them to his own work. He will tax you 1/10 of your flocks. For all practical purpose, you will end up being his slaves. And when the day comes that you realize what you have done to yourselves, and you cry out to the Lord because of the abuses of your king, whom you have chosen for yourselves, the Lord will not answer you in that day." But the people refused to listen to the voice of Samuel. Instead, they said, "No, we are determined to have a king over us, so that we can be just like other nations, and so that our king may govern us and go out before us and fight our battles." When Samuel had heard all the words of the people, he repeated them in the ears of the Lord. The Lord said to Samuel, "Listen to their voice and set a king over them." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will read responsibly Psalm 145. They confronted me in the day of my calamity, but the Lord was my support.
He brought me out into a broad place. He delivered me because he delighted in me.
The Lord rewarded me according to my righteousness. According to the cleanness of my hands, he recompensed me.
For I have kept the ways of the Lord and have not wickedly departed from my God.
For all his ordinances were before me, and his statutes I did not put away from me.
I was blameless before him, and I kept myself from guilt.
Therefore the Lord has recompensed me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hands in his sight.
With the loyal you show yourself loyal. With the blameless you show yourself blameless.
With the pure you show yourself pure, and with the crooked you show yourself perverse.
For you deliver a humble people, but the haughty eyes you bring down.
It is you who light my lamp. The Lord, my God, lights up my darkness.
This God, his way is perfect. The promise of the Lord proves true. He is a shield for all who take refuge in him.
For who is God except the Lord? And who is a rock besides our God?
The God who girded me with strength and made my way safe.
The second lesson is from Colossians 3. Since you have been raised in Christ, turn your attention toward higher ideals that come from where Christ is, sitting at the right of God. Take a point of view that comes from there, above, and not from here below. You need to put to death, then, those things that are of the earth, like abusive and disrespectful conduct regarding sex and sexuality, doing what is not faithful and takes you away from being godly, anxiety about life and living, wishing harm on those you don't like or disagree with, the thinking that your life would be so much better if only you had what others have. These things are how the wrath of God is expressed. And once upon a time, even you lived like that. But now, you need to keep your mouth from being the source of cruel expressions born from inner unrest, expressions of hot rage and unbridled anger, words spoken with the intention of causing harm, anything about God which is just not true, dishonorable words and expressions and outright lies. Having shed your old self and all those things you used to do, and clothing yourself now in Christ instead. Christ, who expressed a full knowledge and understanding of the Father who created him, and in whom the distinctions of class and ethnicity and social status or occupation and even denominational differences no longer set one person higher than another or closer to God than another, but all are one in Christ. So, clothing yourself in Christ, you who are indeed Christ's chosen people, who are holy and loved. So, clothe yourself with the tender mercies of compassion, pity, kindness, a humble evaluative point of view, gentleness, patience in all things with everyone, and being gracious even with those who might rightly owe you something out of what is thought to be just and fair. For as the Lord has been gracious with you in this way, so you must likewise be gracious with others. And to all these things add earnest love, which is what completes our fellowship. And let the peace of Christ be the arbitrator in your hearts, to whom you were called in one body. And be thankful. The word of the Lord.
According to Luke, the 13th chapter. Then Jesus went through one town and village after another, teaching as he made his way to Jerusalem. Along the way, some Pharisees came along and said to Jesus, "Turn and go somewhere else far away from here, for King Herod of Israel has been wanting to kill you." But Jesus said to them, "You go tell that conniving, unfaithful, loser of a king that I say, 'Look, I cast out demons and heal people today and tomorrow, and on the third day my ministry will be complete.' Yet it is necessary for me today, tomorrow, and the next day to go continue on, because it is not possible for a prophet to be destroyed outside of Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem. She is killing the prophets and is stoning those being sent to her. How often I have wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and yet you did not want to be gathered like this. Therefore, behold, your house is being left to you. And I say to you, you may not see me until you will be saying, 'Blessed is the one coming in the name of the Lord.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Lying. Let's be honest with one another. We all lie at some point in some way. I mean, I feel 100% confident that if you said to me, "Oh, Pastor, I never lie," that's at least the second lie you've told. Do you remember the first lie you ever told? I'd be surprised if you did, because we learn to lie at a pretty young age. Psychologists say somewhere between 3 and 4. And in fact, for psychologists, our ability to lie is a positive cognitive marker in our brain development. It means that I'm able to realize that you're not thinking what I'm thinking. Basically, we find lying to be convenient, right? That's why we do it. We learn that if we lie, we might get what we want. Or better yet, if we lie, we might not suffer the consequences of what we have chosen to do or to say. Which is the topic that Jesus is trying to address this morning with the Pharisees, not the topic of lying, but the topic of the consequences of the choices we make. Actually, Jesus is only addressing one choice that we make, the choice to either be faithful or not, which is a pretty simple choice, really. It's one of those binary choices, yes or no, this or that, thumbs up, thumbs down, faithful or not. And it's a choice that the Pharisees are actually presenting to Jesus in the little episode we have. Now, to get what's really going on, we first need to put Jesus in the context of where he is in his life. You know, as I mentioned at the beginning of worship, we have been reading through the Gospel of Luke, trying to go rather sequentially. And, you know, it's been easy to put Jesus in his context in life when it was Christmas and when it was Easter. Right, Gary? Christmas, Easter, you know where Jesus was, right? In the middle, it's understandable that we Lutherans especially can get kind of lost as to what's really going on here. Well, let me remind you that in the Gospel of Luke, there are 10 chapters in the middle here where Jesus is on a journey. For those of you who want to go home and look it up, it's chapters 9 to 19. And Jesus starts out in chapter 9 on the Mount of Transfiguration, and for the next 10 chapters, he spends the whole time journeying to Jerusalem. It's a journey epic, which I think is a brilliant move by the author of the Gospel, because we love journey epics. Journey epics are one of those basic plot lines of great stories. I mean, think of Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings. Or if you're more old school, think about Homer in the Odyssey. Or if you like to watch movies, just think about all those movies about somebody taking a trip that you can stream on Netflix this afternoon. We love journey epics. And the thing we like about them is that somewhere along the way, in the journey, there's a challenge that comes up to the person who's on the journey. There's a moment when we begin to wonder, are they going to make it? Will they achieve their goal or not? I mean, think again of The Lord of the Rings, where it's either Bilbo Baggins or Frodo. I've gotten, you know, two opinions about this in the last two services, so whoever. But one of them is captured by the spiders, and we wonder, is this the end for Frodo or Bilbo? If you like Homer in the Odyssey, you can think about those beautiful sirens who are on the cliffs singing their beautiful song to distract the sailors and make them run their ship against the rocks. Will they get where they're going? If you want another great journey epic from the Bible, just turn back to the Old Testament, to the first book, Genesis, and read there about the journey epic of Abraham and Sarah. It is an excellent story full of cliffhangers about whether Abraham is actually going to get where God wants him to go, whether God is actually going to be able to fulfill the promise that God has made to Abraham. I reiterate to you again that if you think the Bible is boring, you just haven't read the Bible. I mean, this is a page turner in Genesis. And here we have Jesus in the middle of his journey epic, being challenged by the Pharisees to give up on the trip that he's taking and go another way. And the Pharisees want Jesus not to go to Jerusalem because they know that if Jesus goes to Jerusalem, he's going to die. But you know, that's no news to us. We've been following Jesus in this journey ever since he began. And since he began, Jesus has been telling us, I am going to Jerusalem. It's part of God's plan and God's path for me. And when I get there, I am going to suffer and die. Everybody knows this. The thing is that it seems everyone has either not listened fully to Jesus or they've forgotten what Jesus has said, because after he says, I'm going to suffer and die, he always says, and on the third day, rise. But the Pharisees, they didn't hear that part. Nor did the disciples, nor did anybody else really. They're all stuck on the fact that where Jesus is going, there's only suffering and death. The way of faithfulness is suffering and death. And so they want Jesus to go a different way. Which is kind of how our life of faith goes too, right? I mean, there are plenty out there who are saying, no, don't go that way. There's an easier way. No, the way to be successful is really this way. The way to have a good life, it's really this way. Not the way of faith. The way of faith leads to suffering and death. So I think that it's important for us to hear five quick takeaways from this little episode of Jesus with the Pharisees. Just five. The first is that the life of faith is a journey. It is a path that we follow, which begins at the baptismal font and ends in the resurrection. At this moment, we are on the way. We have not arrived anywhere. You have a long way to go, thanks be to God. That's the first thing we need to remember. The second is that along this journey, it is our journey epic. And like journey epics, there are going to be challenges along the way which make it seem like we may not get where we're supposed to go. We may go in a different direction. There will be those who say there's an easier way, a better way. Because let's face it, this journey of faith, it ain't easy. Did you hear all that stuff that Margaret read from Colossians 3? All those things that you're supposed to do if you want to be a faithful person? Come on, that's not easy. That involves discipline. There are going to be challenges as we go along this journey of faith, temptations to go in a different direction, give up, do something else. But the third thing we learn from this little episode with Jesus and the Pharisees is that if we decide to take another direction, God is going to leave us to the consequences of the choices that we make. We see that in the story in a way that's not completely obvious. I wish Jesus sometimes would just, you know, give it to us boldface. But Jesus is talking with the Pharisees about how they want Jesus to go in a different direction, not to Jerusalem. And Jesus mentions to them, you know, this is typical of you guys. You are constantly avoiding going to God for God's comfort and protection. You're going a different way. And the consequence is that they don't receive God's protection. If you know the history, the consequence is it doesn't turn out so well for the Pharisees, actually. There are consequences to the choices we make, and God leaves us to those consequences. That's kind of the new thing that God does post-Jesus. You know, pre-Jesus, the complaint Lutherans have about the Old Testament is that when someone strays from the faith, God usually ends up being angry and then doing something wrathful and punishing to them, you know, exiling them, fire and brimstone on them. Not post-Jesus. After Jesus, God says, fine, Doug, you want to do that? Let's see how it works out for you. And how does it work out for you? You know, sometimes, admittedly, there are few consequences to choosing to not be faithful. I mean, really, what are the consequences of not engaging in worship every week? Oh, I get to sleep in, and I get to have coffee and donuts on my deck? Oh, that's such a hard consequence. And you know, we're Lutheran, so if I was to say to you something like, well, if you don't come to worship every week, you're going to hell, you would think I was joking, right? You'd all laugh, hopefully. Hear that, you'd think, oh, pastor's gone a little bit off the wagon here. But there are unfaithful paths which have more tangible consequences. I mean, like, what are you getting from holding on to that anger rather than trying to forgive and reconcile a relationship that hasn't gone well? What benefit are you receiving from not living a life of gratitude and gratefulness to God for all the blessings you've received? Why are you embarrassing yourself by saying, I'm a Christian, and then speaking or writing words on social media which are only meant to be bitter and demeaning rather than an invitation to entering into dialogue and deeper understanding? We learn from this episode that there are consequences to our actions, and God often just leaves us to the consequences of what we choose. But then the final thing we do learn from this episode is that if we turn back, if we decide that going in the way of unfaithfulness really isn't what we want to do, we want to get back on the way of faithfulness, God welcomes us and celebrates that we are back. We hear this again in kind of a convoluted way in this episode when Jesus mentions that God always wants to bring God's people together under his protection and safety, like a hen wants to gather her brood under her wings. That's what God wants, always. We just need to remember the story of the prodigal son. Do you remember that parable that Jesus tells? He told it a while ago in the gospel. Remember the younger son who goes off on a different path. When he returns to the father, what does the father do? Welcomes him. Celebrates that he's back. This is what awaits us when we choose to return to faithfulness. So look, God doesn't need to be wrathful and angry at you. God just says, okay, that's what you want to do. Let's see how that works out for you. And by the way, remember and trust that God is here, always ready to welcome and celebrate that you've decided to return to the path of life. You know, it's something we don't need to lie about at all. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. My petitions will end with gracious Lord, and the congregation, please respond, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, help us to be bold and continually inspired to tell others of our experience of your greatness and glory in our lives. Help us to remember our baptism and give thanks that in Christ and through the Holy Spirit, our new identity as children and heirs of God is revealed, shaped, and guided, so that we may live our faith with confidence and joy and serve our neighbor with compassion, mercy, and generosity. Gracious Lord,
hear our prayer.
O God, mighty and immortal, you know that as fragile creatures surrounded by great dangers, we cannot by ourselves stand upright. Grant us strength of mind and body so that even when we suffer because of human sin, we may rise victorious through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Gracious Lord,
hear our prayer.
We thank you, Lord, for the gift that is Great Grace Lutheran, for fellowship, wonderful opportunities for worship and service, as well as educational opportunities for all ages to grow in our spiritual lives. We thank you for the gift that is Pastor Chris and our parish musician, Becky, as well as all of our lay leaders and volunteers. Encourage members to assist with our mission of our Sunday school that will be starting shortly. Gracious Lord,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the boldness to make us good stewards of our creation. Help us to fully integrate creation care into our love of God and neighbor. May you guide our hands to support the mission of the Garden of Hope, which provides healthy and nutritious foods that the neediest in our community often can't access due to cost. Gracious Lord,
hear our prayer.
We still pray for an end to the invasion of Ukraine and the violence inflicted upon its citizens, for the safety and well-being of its refugees, for the healing of its communities and restoration of its infrastructure. May we be strengthened as instruments of peace where there is none, and serve the needs of our neighbors in all complexities life presents. God calls us to be for others, just as God in Christ is for us. Gracious Lord,
hear our prayer.
Dear Lord, strengthen us that we as individuals, a church, and a society will reaffirm our commitment to repent for the sins of racism and white supremacy, and that the Spirit will change our hearts and lead us to value, love, and welcome all people as the wonderful handiwork of God. Gracious Lord,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all in need. Rescue those experiencing mental illness or struggling with addiction. Ease the anxiety of those who live with dementia and provide strength for their caregivers. Command your angels concerning all who are sick, including those we now name before you, either silently or aloud. Olivia, Adam, Joy. Gracious Lord,
hear our prayer. It is into your hands, O Lord, that we commend ourselves and all whom for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of our Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of God's peace with each other. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Let us pray.
Living God, we praise you for the abundant blessings of this life. In humble recognition of the love you always show to us, we bring these gifts and ourselves as our thanks. Use them and us to bear the fruit of goodness and grace, so that your glory will be known to all.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, almighty and merciful God. You are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things necessary for our salvation. It was he who, in the night he was handed over, took the bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying to them, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for my remembrance." Then, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for them to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for my remembrance." Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
Just a quick reminder that as you come forward to receive, everyone who seeks the invitation of Christ is welcome to the table. Please grab a empty glass from the trays that are in the aisle here, or if you'd like grape juice, that's in the pre-filled glass in the middle.
Thank you.
death.
Let us pray.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, Lord, for the renewing and refreshing our bodies and souls with the bread of grace, the wine of reconciliation, the fellowship of faithful friends, and the word of radical enlightenment. As we go back out now to the joys and trials, the tasks and tedium, the wonder and worry that is life, sustain us with your Spirit. May we fully digest our feasting on this bread, wine, fellowship, and word, that we will be nurtured to remain consistently faithful in all that we say and do, and that all around us will see and know that we are yours. We ask this in the name of the one who gave his life that we may live, Jesus the Christ.
Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Amen. Just a quick reminder that we do have ice cream out here in the narthex to celebrate Holy Cow Sunday 2. It's our fundraiser for St. Mary's Food Pantry, so come on out and enjoy some organic, locally made, crazy flavored ice cream. I mean, really, be adventuresome. Just stretch yourself this morning. And then make a nice donation to St. Mary's Food Pantry to help those who are food insecure in our community right now. If you're online and you'd like to support St. Mary's Food Pantry, you can do so by going to Grace's website, graceyorktown.org, and click on the donate button. There'll be a pull-down menu that shows St. Mary's Food Pantry. You can donate that way. Sorry, we still haven't figured out how to do ice cream virtually, but you can do DoorDash, I guess, or something like that. Anyway.
Go in peace. to serve the Lord.
Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Okay, no Christmas bonus this year.